So as Mr. Dupont said, my name is Evangelos Konstantinou and I'm currently a professor of anesthesiology at the Vascular Access at National Ethical University of Athens. We also, me and my colleague, dear Theodoros Katsoulas, are running two vascular access laboratories. Okay, again. In private and in public sector as well. This is my disclosure form, honorariums. So, you will allow me to start with a great ancient Greek author, Homer, the legendary author of the Iliad and the Odyssey, who wrote the two epic poems, which are the central works of ancient Greek literature, and a word that it is called in Greek proekonomia, or foreshadowing. That's the English translation for proekonomia, which is the act of saying something that you will support at the next paragraph. So, if I have to talk about the state of the art in vascular access, I have to tell you firstly what is not the state of the art in vascular access, and allow me to show you four photographs that were taken about one in my hospital, which has an IV dedicated nurse-led team, and two other beautiful pictures. You know, this is a 22 gauge catheter on the toe, and you can see now a very nice extravasation. So, allow me to introduce you, according to my opinion, the state of the art in vascular access. This is the state of the art in vascular access. This is a very high puncture, a very big vein, a very big diameter, a very small catheter, 5 or 6 French, a long subcutaneous route, a very small incision, less than 1 centimeter, that is, of course, is closed using hyanocrylate glue. Transparent, the white one, not the other that our dear colleague mentioned with the blue color. Why do we use VADs in general? I'm quite sure that everybody knows that. To avoid multiple vein puncture of the patient, ideally we have one patient, one therapy, one surgery, one hospitalization, just with one puncture, that with a needle of 27 gauge for the local anesthesia, to have a long-term vascular access device to withdraw blood samples from the patient, to use it for contrast administration, and to increase the concentration of the drug, to use it during operations, to reduce or eliminate, this is the optimal scope of ours, to eliminate the pain, and to reduce personnel's working overload to administer irritating IV drug, such as ciprofloxacin or amiodarone, for example, and of course, mostly to avoid extravasation, which is a very, 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 very bad complication for the patients. So what choices to have today? PICC lines, centrally inserted central ports, PICC ports, and midlines. I won't talk anymore about midlines because, according to my opinion, in the next month or maybe years, midlines will definitely be replaced by peripheral IVs that are made of polyurethane 3 generation, just the same material like the PICCs. And it's supposed to use these catheters for 31 days. So I think that midlines will be in another scale in the use of vascular access devices because that device doesn't need, at least as they say, an ultrasound device in order to be placed. It's just a peripherally inserted vascular access catheter. I won't talk about companies. I don't want to talk about the specific company that participate, but I think that there are 2 or 3 that will launch the product in the market. PICCs versus ports in general. PICCs are not as comfortable as ports. No one has to have a cable on his hand, that's for sure. Hygiene harder to manage when you have a PICC line. They usually have lower flow, not efficient for big volume, because the PICC line is 4 or 4.5 French, and of course the classic port is 7 French to 9 French. We have to care about the device every 7 versus 21 days. But of course, on the other hand, PICCs are ideally for hospitalized patients. We have no incisions or visible scars, and of course we have no major complication. Several studies have proved that PICC port catheters are as effective as the central catheters. But why PICC ports instead of central ports? All the studies can prove that all these devices that can implant it at the upper lip can provide safety and comfort benefits at the patient. They are effective as the classic chest ports. And of course, they can use safely to administer long-term chemotherapy in female and male, of course, cancer patients. So, since the subclavian vein should be avoided, I could say prohibited, but I don't want to be very aggressive about that. It's the only vein we can see at the ultrasound. If you want a vein at the upper chest wall, you can also use the axillary vein, which is very highly demonstrated with ultrasound as a choice, not by everybody and not in all facilities worldwide. We just have to deal with axillary vein puncture if we want to go for a chest wall. So there is a very interesting paper by Mauro Cotiruti, who else, about how to make the axilla, the axillary vein, larger. And I want you to try it when you go back to your facilities with that kind of pillow. You can increase the diameter of the vein even at 100%. But you can see the pleura. You can still see the pleura. See the pleura? So that means that if somebody is not quite experienced, if he's not well trained, then he always can puncture the pleura and then provoke a pneumothorax. And that's something we don't want to do. Of course, you can't provoke a pneumothorax if you are going to place a PICC port. That's very difficult, even for an untrained person. So in both cases, at least in our mind, in our facility, we don't have any need for operating room, radiology or interventional suite, navigation systems. There are absolutely no need for navigation systems in vascular access business because we have the best navigation system, which is the ECG. It's not exactly cheap. It's for free. It has zero cost. Okay? And of course, no one needs any assistant. What about patients that have atrial fibrillation? You can use the ECG, or you can use some other methods that now are described. There is a very good and very nice guy. He's a former postgraduate student of mine, Emmanuel Stafilarakis, that has developed a mathematical model using anatomical landmarks, and he claims that he can say exactly how many centimeters is the root from the point of puncture until the caveoid rejection. But I can't tell you anymore because it will be the theme of his doctoral dissertation, and he's now working very hard on it. PICC ports versus chest ports, or centrally inserted catheters that are attached to a port, if we want to speak more correctly. No major complications such as pneumothorax, no visible scars. It's a totally invasive, non-invasive procedure. Brachial artery is easy to compress in case of accidental puncture. You can do that with subclavian artery or even the axillary artery. It's very difficult. Increased fatigue satisfaction and less pain for the patient and minimum exposure for the patient as well. Of course, always maximal bearing precautions. Chlorhexidine increases the success rate in first puncture. Acute, never right or obtuse angle for puncture of the vein with a macro reducer. We don't believe in the famous 45-degree angle. Large diameter of the vein. And, of course, small diameter of the catheter. The famous rule that 1/3. We always have to have a long subcutaneous route. In our facility, we tunnel every single catheter. Since we have the chance to observe Mrs. Gloria Ortiz in the United States with the famous 14 PIV catheter, then we tunnel every single PICC line. No stitches at all, never. Keonocrylate medical glue, sufficient subcutaneous tissue over the reservoir in order to avoid skin Dickinson, small reservoir, low profile reservoir, and proper nursing care. All patients are referred to our nurse-led team by medical doctors, oncologists in most of the cases, internists, surgeons, etc., etc., etc. We take care about the length of the therapy, the scheme of the therapy, if the patient is hospitalized or not, the diameter of the veins, jugular, brachial, basilic, axillary, the need for large volume in administration, the patient's choice, and of course, because we are a country under memorandum, the availability of the devices. I don't know if that happens to other countries, but it happens to my country. I can assure you about that. All patients have about half an hour ago. They also take all the drugs, their medications. They have breakfast. They have coffee, whatever they want. And then they go home soon after that. We connect them with the 3-lead monitor, as you all know. And we explain them. Possible complications. I know that's all Greek for you, but I can explain you what it is. We said that you may have some incidence of thrombosis. We have a very low rate of thrombosis, 1.01%, because we go high. Infection, twist off, rotate of the port, very, very, very rare. We never see this, and we never suture the port in the fascia. Skin Dickinson's, we see it sometimes. Catheter occlusion, catheter fracture, and leakage. We pay attention to previous thrombosis, axillary lymph node dissection, etc., etc. And of course, we always ask for the dominant arm and his preferences, the patient's preferences. We pay respect at the Robert Dawson's zone of method, but only from the point of implantation, not for the puncture point. We puncture very high. We puncture in the axilla always, or almost of the time. And of course, we have to create a long subcutaneous route. So, do you remember proeconomia for shadowing? What do we have now? We have 10 centimeters long subcutaneous route. We have the point of entrance, and we have the small incision. It's totally, totally unexpected to have an infection here that could be ever turned to a catheter-related bloodstream infection. It's 10 centimeters of a very effective barrier that is the subcutaneous tissue. And I have also to tell you that we never infiltrate the subcutaneous tissue during the tunneling because it doesn't pain. It's totally useless to infiltrate the root. Known patient pains during the directed of the tunneler through the subcutaneous. They are, the pain is at the skin only, here and there. So if you go high, you will see the veins connected and format one vein. So this is the point you have to puncture. A very big diameter, a very, very big diameter, and a very small catheter. This is the first port we implanted, the first PICC port, about 6 years ago. You see, this is a vertical incision. That was the first time and the last we did the vertical incision. And the very funny thing, and very, very not funny, not exactly funny, the very good thing for us and the patient is that the patient, even if he had pancreatic cancer, he's still alive and free of the disease. So we are very happy with him. He is a doctor. He's a medical doctor. Yeah, yeah. It's something that everybody doesn't know how it happened. Yes, yes. And the port is still functioning. Yes. Okay. You see the port here and the incision here. It was our first one. Of course, Nancy Morrow would say that, oh, look, axilla is a very dirty part of the human body. Okay, we respect that. What happens? Happens exactly what happens in lymph node dissection after mastectomy. Nothing. Have you ever seen infection of the incision when somebody has a lymph node dissection? Because we have chlorhexidine and of course we have the 8-butanoacrylate glue. So, when implanted, don't be afraid of the big bad glue, clumsy and catheter-related bloodstream infection. If you have used maximal barrier precautions every single time you implant the port, and of course, when you don't have well, or you have well-trained and supportive colleagues. We used to say in Greece that a boat owner is very happy twice in his life, the day he boats the boat and the day he sells it. The interval is hell. So we are very happy when we plant and when we remove the catheter. But in the meantime, maintenance is the 99% of the patient's care. Placement is 1%. So you really have to have supportive colleagues or take care of your colleagues, of your patients by yourself. We talked about the advantages, infection rates, reduced thrombosis rates, is reduced, you can puncture whatever you want and you can implant whatever you want. There are three rare disadvantages, lymph node dissection in both axillas, we don't see it very often, thrombosis in big vessels at the upper lip, and small diameter of the vein, less than 5 millimeters, that can't be happened if you go very high at the point we saw you before. So we can choose any vein you want, and of course you can refuse the infection rate. How can we do that? If possible, we apply lidocaine, 2%, or ointment, EMLA ointment. It's lidocaine and prilocaine ointment. Well, it was checked and got disordered, the patient's name, the therapeutic schedule of the patient, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We applied disinfection with chlorhexidine, maybe with povidone-iodine, not so much difference. And of course, we flush the catheter with normal saline in order to avoid air emboli. It's a very rare but a very aggressive complication if you live it, if you experience it once in your life. We had the chance to see it, and I can tell you that it was like a thriller. We used 27G for local anesthesia needle. We identified the basilica or the brachial vein, or we may go higher. We infiltrate with lidocaine, 2%. Just 2 cubic centimeters are enough. We perform a very small incision at the pre-selected point of puncture, if we are quite sure that we will succeed, otherwise the patient will have constant stitches on his upper lip. That's not good. We puncture the vein using an 80G needle, included in the set always. Okay. We see the needle, the tip of the needle in the vein. If we don't see the tip of the needle in the vein, then we can do nothing about it. And then we place the needle into the vein. And we observe that there is sufficient back flow from the vein. So the next time, the next thing we have to do is to advance the wire, not all of it, of course. I can understand why some people have in the sets 60 centimeters wire. It's totally useless. And, of course, we make sure that we can advance it and pull it back smoothly after we remove the needle. We advance the introducer over the wire and make way in the skin, the subcutaneous tissue, and the wall of the vessel. We check one more time if we can pull the wire smoothly and remove it. We see that blood but not involved introducers. We prefer not valved introducers because we want to see that blood and be sure that we are in the vein. We see that we have that backflow, that means that our seed is in the vein. Then we remove the dilator very carefully, we close the seed, and we advance our catheter. Of course, we check if the catheter goes up to the internal jugular vein because of the possibility always exists. Then we connect temporarily the port to the catheter without using the connection rings, and we make the famous ECG method. We don't have to pay for very expensive navigation systems. We don't need very expensive navigation systems because even the navigation systems, they use the ECG and the Doppler additionally, of course, but it has nothing to do with that because if you are experienced enough, you can understand if your catheter goes into the heart or not. Then we use a Haber needle, a forceps, and we just connect a monitor. So we have the heart, the saline, the monitor, and what we want to see is the famous P-wave elevation. If you go close to the heart, you see that the P-wave elevates, 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 and when it's at the maximal point, that seems that it is close to the sinus. As we well know, the sinus is at the cavo atrial junction. So we have the tip of the catheter at the cavo atrial junction. So there is no need for fluoroscopy, no need for an X-ray postoperatively. It's a waste of money, it's a waste of human resources. I have to remind you that 1 hour in the operating theater or 1 hour in a dedicated interventional suite costs about 800 euros an hour, not the whole intervention. Soon after that, we break the sieve under constantly ECG monitoring. And we compress, of course, using the gauze. You see, it has never moved. So we have the tip of the catheter at the point we want, and we infiltrate with lidocaine 2% in order to create the pocket. It is very important to mention that if you infiltrate with lidocaine 2% and normal saline, the volume of the drug you will administer will practically create the pocket. So you don't have to do any other movements. You don't have to have coagulation with you. We never use coagulation because we have the volume. So we infiltrate, we make a very big gap between the tissue. If you observed, we just had 2 cc of lidocaine at the beginning. And that's the whole lidocaine we use. We can also infiltrate with normal saline in order to avoid further hemorrhage during the incision. And we perform a small incision in order to implant the port. Nowadays, we make smaller incisions. That was kind of big one because the port was bigger than the usual. One move, one pocket. Forceps, open, pocket. And of course, we take care that we have to have enough subcutaneous tissue above the pocket in order to avoid skin dehiscence. Just a fingertip, we make the tunnel using a 2.5 millimeters tunneler, which always is included in the set. We advance the tunneler through the subcutaneous tissue, and then we connect the catheter with the tunneler. We pull it back. And the only thing now we want to do, of course, is to connect the catheter to the port. We put the connection ring. Please take care about when you cut the catheter, not to happen something like that happened to us 5 years ago. Okay? You can see what happened to us. We lost the catheter. The catheter was aspirated in the vessel like a spaghetti inside. Yeah. It was very impressive. He did, took a deep breath and saw it was a negative CVP and the catheter left in the heart. So you have to avoid it. If you're going to be good vascular access specialists and practitioners, we connect it, we close it, and then we suture the device under the subcutaneous tissue. After finishing, of course, we do some the famous bearing knots, and we put glue up to that. We connect one more time the port in order to check if the port, after all this manipulation, is still at the proper position. So, if you connect and we have the same thing, this is the final picture that we will have. Port, hyper needle, the catheter, etc., etc. We have stopped taking X-rays since 3 years from now. About complications, I have to say, to tell you about a rare complication that was a persistent left superior vena cava syndrome that led to a catheter malposition during PICC port placement. It was published in the Journal of Vascular Access, so we had then to go to the left, to the right arm of the patient in order to put it. And of course, we have some rare complication such as thrombosis. I have to ask you all something. What do you do if you have a PICC line, for example? Not a PICC port, a PICC line, that it is thrombosed. You? You leave it there? Yes, definitely. Definitely, because that's the story of my life. About 5 minutes ago, before my presentation, they told me, it seems to be red. Shall we remove it because it may have thrombosis? No, you just have to have an ultrasound to detect if it is thrombosis or it is not a thrombosis or you think it is red, and then you leave it there and you have some small injections for 3 or 6 months because the device is functioning. The tip of the catheter is at the cable atrial junction. You don't have a remove. It will be a recanalization in 6 months or so. And of course, every patient has a hotline mobile number so that he can come in contact with a nurse who performed the operation 24 hours a day. That's not good for us, but it's good for the patients. And all patients will receive a leaflet where all technical aspects related to the vascular access devices are well described and instruction for anyone as to whom it may concern, under nurses, physicians in other hospitals, etc. Oh, it seems that I've finished. This is Mykonos. And I have a strong feeling that many of you will have the chance to visit it in the next 2 years. So looking forward to see you in 2 years' time in Athens, Greece. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.